Ayodhyan citizens were alerted one day by the sound of this horn. It is so profound, like Anhadnad. And then they started wondering. A most elegant fortune teller arrived in the city. Soon it was known that he specializes in seeing the fortune of the children. Just by glancing at them and observing the lines of their palms and forehead, whenever he predicts, he blows his horn fully with echoes in all directions. People rush to see the tall holy man. He had a camphor white complexion, a crown of matted hair. Sacred ashes were pasted on his forehead, and he was wearing Rudraksha beads, and ornaments were on his arms and wrists, on his ankles and in his ears. He was sparkling, and a golden covered book was in his hand. A child was sitting in his lap, and he was talking to him, telling his future. Nearby, his young student was standing holding his deerskin seat and water pot. "Where from have you arrived, O blessed one?" the citizens asked the student. "Do you see this holy river Sarayu?" the student asked in turn, and they nodded their heads all the way back to her origin. In the silvery hills of the Himalayas, there is a heavenly hermitage, and there lives my guru. He sees the entire range of one's fortune like a reflection in a mirror, or a scene of some movie screen, television screen. Your future, your past, your present, everything is seen by him. But now, my guru looks only to babies, children, newborn babies. As soon as he looks, like a laser beam he looks, a flash of light, and all the fortunate events of the line zoom into him. The student explained to the crowd. They were invited in many, many homes and mansions, and the guru peered at the lines of the souls and palms of the different babies. He told wonderful things, but the one which pleased the people most was his prediction that their baby would attain closeness to the prince regent. No, these glittering stones are already scattered like bricks around my guru's hermitage. No use to carry them, please keep them. We don't accept anything other than a few bananas and rabri malai, that is the pure vegetarian and light food, when we are hungry, and now we are not. Thus they refused any form of payment or gift, my dear friend. A maid went running to the Nile Palace and informed, "Oh, your majesty, oh great queens, Kaushalya and Sumitra and Kaikeyi, there is such a great fortune teller who just came into our city, and he is knower of all the three times. He picks up a child in his lap and tells all the future. He looks magnanimous and illustrious." "Did he tell your fortune?" asked Kaikeyi. "My fortune is safe in the service of your majesty. I don't need to know about mine. He is expert in child's fortune reading especially. They have still not accepted their lunch yet. Please go and invite them to palace immediately. Extend invitation for lunch here too. No one should go from our city without a nice feast." Kausalya added, "As soon as the yogi appeared in the palace, he blew his trumpet full, and it echoed all over the town, my dear friends. All the queens and King Dasharatha greeted him in the royal entrance way. They offered their pranams and escorted he and his student to inside the palace in the living room. They offered the yogi a beautiful seat spread with a new white silk sheet. The yogi sat cross-legged and the mothers worshipped him and his student as well. By then, dozens of visiting queens and friends had arrived. When the mother brought their children, the yogi picked up the first one and set him in his lap. He went on peering at his tiny lotus feet and then at the lines of his palms. He looked at his forehead, his face, and then all of his limbs. Baby Ram and the yogi smiled at one another. Yogi became filled and don't know what he was. What he was talking to the child. When he turned and waved around him his matted hair and blessed him, he told Sri Ram's good fortune, good future in great detail. One by one he took all princes and talked to each and then told their fortune. "Dear Kong, one, come here please. Do you see these lines? What do they stand for?" The yogi showed some lines of each prince and asked his student, "Doesn't it stand for sovereignty, my lord?" He answered, "And that, what about this?" The yogi and his student went on as if he is going to teach not only his student but all the visitors of the whole of his wisdom. All queens were delighted, a heartfelt feasting followed, everyone partook and left for their abode. "My lord, you are going to Kailash, but I would like to be here sometime." "Oh, Kagushundi, enjoy, be here in the form of a crow." Lord Shiva gave his sanction and blessing and departed. And Kagushundi settled in one of the lush green bushes of Sarayu bank and made a beautiful nest. There he began living in the form of a sweet little crow. Everyone began to notice that a smooth, small, beautiful crow started visiting the yard of Kausalya every day. Whenever he comes, all other birds move aside and give him way. They revere him as if he was their unannounced king. Wherever he goes, all the birds give him the way and remain silent and respectful as long as he is present. He doesn't take anything offered to him, but as soon as anything slips and drips and falls from any of the prince's mouth, he rushes and picks them up and eats them and enjoys it so much and then flies away, my dear friend. All these princes too have become so interested in this crow and they forget even their toys and keep on playing with him. Today he snatched the bread dipped in kheer from the hands of Ram as soon as he ate half and was holding it, moving around the crow. Agro grabbed the calf and flew above. He sat on the golden on the top, on the rooftop nearby, and started eating. Looking below, many other birds too were sitting here and there, and Ram and Lakshman and Parvati and Shatrughna all clapped and laughed and enjoying the birds' different frolics, which they do to attract the attention of the little princess. They are doing, showing a piece of bread, vegetable, or barfi, or rasgulla. Ram allures the crow sitting on the rooftop to come and get it. When he comes close, then Ram runs back to the room and he laughs. When he goes away, Ram calls him again, showing the nice eatable, and the crow flies down again. Then he opens a chum-chum, a rasgulla, a rasmalai, and shows him, and when he comes to grab, Ram runs away, hides somewhere. E aakil kat mohi dharan jab bhaavahi, chalo bhaag tab poop dikhaavahi. This leela happens, takes place again and again and again. At last the crow snatches the bread and flies to some nearby tree branch. Bhojan karat bol jab raja, nahi aavat taj baal samaja. Eha kausalya jab bolan ja, ठुमुक ठुमुक प्रभु चल ही पराए. My blissful gorgeous self, Saint Tulsidas ji describes in his beautiful poem narrations. एहां निगमनेत शिव अंकन पावा, काई धरनि जननी हठि धावा. एहां धूसर धूरि भरे तनुयाए, भूपति बिहति गोद बैठाए. एहां भोजन करत चपल चित, इतउत अवसर पाए. भाज जले गिलगद मुख, दधियोदन lapitai. He keeps jumping around these three princes. then the tribe touch him and he leaps away. When they go away, he comes closer and closer to them, the queens, the ministers, the sons, and the king. All have begun loving that crow whom their beloved Ram loves so much and plays with. At the end of the long day playing, when they all are tired, the little crow climbs in Sri Ram's lap and Rama pets his smooth black feathers until he takes a nap. It is very sweet seeing this. Everyone has begun to love this crow, my dear friend, more, and all want to feed him. They make the most delicious thing, but he does not touch any of them. He keeps looking at Ram and cawing. Then when Ram takes a bit and gives, only then he picks it up with his beak. Then Ram gargles and he claps. कलमल वचन अधर अरुणारे, एहां दोई दोई दसन विशद मुरवारे. He spends his nights in a tree at Sarayu bank and takes a dip early morning. morning, watches the sunrise and dries his feet as Sun Rama looked up. As soon as sun is up, he calls and calls. Lo, hearing his calling, Ram comes running, his head full of sweet balls, eating a little and dropping a lot around him, moves across the jewels patio of Kausalya's pavilion, and runs across the soft green grass and around the flower bed. He goes down by the lotus park, where there are large ponds of multicolored lotuses, spreading their petals, spreading their perfume in early morning sunrise and mingling their fragrance in the breeze. Sri Ram likes a bluish emerald moves amongst the soft grass, bushes, trees and lotus ponds, his ankles and hip bells ringing. He carries sweet balls and plays with his friend, who flies tree to tree, rock to rock, roof to roof. Eha peet jheeni jhanguli tanu soi, kilakani chitavani bhavati moi. In the midday after lunch, when all the brothers are resting, Kagabhushandi keeps silence and moves around looking here and there. When they are inside, he keeps gazing at that gate beyond which the princes are napping. He keeps looking and looking with great intensity. When all four brothers come out in the yard, then he flies back to a tree branch and keeps looking, my dear friends. Thus, in front of his eyes, Sri Ram grew and grew, and he began running and playing with him. Then he would chase him, and at times, and downs around him too. He lived on his leftovers. Thus, he lived for 5 years, my dear friend. Then what happened? Sometimes Ram would cry too, and when he cried, it would become very difficult to discover why he is crying. The queen's horn would begin churning, maids would sigh repeatedly, King Dasarath would come and torment and say, Vasishtha would come running, "Oh, Ram is crying, he is upset." This news was too sad for the Ayodhyan citizens. Crying and crying, his two large eyes like lotus petals were wet and smeared with tears, as if some monsoon season has come and is waiting all the lotuses early. His happy smile disappeared in the shadow of his upset. Thinking of the heart feels as if going torn off. Ram is crying, then Bharat too is crying, then Lakshman's face too has gone red, and his lips are fluttering, reddish eyes gazing at his brother, and Shatrughna too is very sad. What to do now? Far away in the distance, in the forest, the birds too have felt this cry, and they have also become silent, my dear friend. Hiding their faces in their wings, lo, they too are lying in the nest corners crying. Deers also stop leaping and are thinking, why this sudden cloud of sadness? Calves have stopped jumping around, cows are despondent. Lions have gone in their dens in deep melancholia. It is only Sage Vasishtha who figures out the real cause. Sometimes some sage arrived in the outskirts of